So with the new workshop up and running, I thought it was about time I introduce you to a new project. I've had this engine for about a year and realised that I haven't actually made any film with it yet. I took lots of pictures in its as found state. It's a circa 1920 Stuart Turner P3. I'm really not sure what this engine was originally used for, know nothing more about it other than its most recent history. Needs quite a lot of work to put it right. The first kind of stumbling block was that the flywheel put up a real fight. I couldn't remove it at first. The gib key was the problem. Looks like it's been driven in far too tight at some stage in the engine's life, and the other side of the flywheel boss is actually cracked. There's a small fracture from the front which extends about a quarter of an inch into the inside bore of the flywheel boss. That's probably going to be an outside job to repair that. It's a bit too big for my lathe, which isn't a gap bed, I'm afraid, so not something I can tackle. The keyway is also going to need to be recut, so that's a bit of a specialist job. As you'll see in the next piece of film, the flywheel was removed using a 12-ton press, and that made light work of the job. That was with the key in place, which, having drilled it, which is why the keyway needs to be recut, having drilled it, it was weakened enough to remove it. I'd made a guide actually to try and remove the key, but I drilled a little further than I had intended to do so. It's the usual Stuart Turner method of ball bearing main bearings with a spacer between the two on the crank, all retained by this locking nut, which had worked completely loose. All of that fits in this housing, which, as you can see, is going to need some repair. I was pretty gentle removing that, but obviously not enough, and a piece broke off as I pulled the housing away from the main engine casting. The crank itself is going to need some fairly major repairs. The crank pin looks a bit messy, but I think we'll be able to use that again. The only slight concern is the slightly ovaled end of the pin with the flats on it, where it engages with another little crank web at the back which does the magneto drive. But again, that's kind of the same wear as we saw on the Stuart N3 project, so a similar sort of repair required there. I'm gonna have to learn the art of metal stitching for that repair. It shouldn't be too difficult because of the piece that's come off nice and complete. Someone suggested to me I could fix that in place with a kind of epoxy resin, make a band to hold it tight, and then I can put in a couple of metal staples and drill and tap all the way around for a proper stitch repair. I think we'll have a go at that. The other issue is with the front crank bearing. This one is actually held on the crank with these tin shims inside, packing it out. Probably an acceptable method of repair back in the day, but not really these days. And the crank is very wasted. I suspect it's had a spun bearing at some time. So I think what we'll do is reduce the outside diameter of that area, and then we can make a couple of shells. I could turn a bush that would put that back to size and then split it, and again epoxy each side on. It would be a very thin shell, I might add, so as not to reduce the strength of this area too much, and then the bearing can be pressed over it. So that's how I intend to repair that. The engine itself is quite an interesting thing. I haven't seen one on the rally field around here in about 6 years. But I was quite taken with its flywheel governor, which is quite an interesting device. The engine doesn't appear to have any frost damage, not that I've found yet. Again, it's very similar to what the construction of the Stuart N3 was, although that was a later engine. It's quite interesting to see the continuation of their design. But you can see this overhung crank web. Pleasingly, this one has a bronze big end bearing, so that's something that I can tackle easily at home. I can press that out and make a new one. I'll have to get a reamer of the appropriate size, and we'll be able to make something decent. One of the other things that attracted me to this engine was the Coke bottle style exhaust. It just looks kind of like a baby Petterim type. One of the other things was the, going back to the flywheel, the cast-in pulley. It's quite an ornate bit of design. So it's quite an interesting little engine, missing the magneto, but otherwise fairly well complete. So on this project there should be lots of bits of film at the lathe making bits and pieces. I'll try and make it as interesting as I can. Recently got a Myford vertical milling slide, which fits on there with the T-slots and bolts in place of the top slide there. So that should greatly increase the capability of the machine here. Need to get a few bits, need to get a collet chuck to go on the spindle and some collets to hold the end mills, but it's something I'm looking forward to having a go at. Going back to the engine, my intention once it's restored is to pair it with a suitable generator. If we come over here, we've got a little Crompton, as it was then called, a continuous current four pole machine, shunt wound. It's only capable of about 6 or 7 amps current, and at the moment I've had trouble with the voltage dropping by about 5 volts over an hour or so's running. It then drops to say you're running at 25, it'll drop to 20 and it will stay there all day long, and that may be to do with the poor condition of the shunt cables. Obviously the windings are very old, so I need to do a few tests on the machine, see that it will actually be up to the job. But it's a very nice Crompton machine, well worth saving. and very old now. So that's the intention, and it should make for a really nice little lighting set, something like that, but a bit smaller, and hopefully with a proper separate slate switchboard. Got all the bits and pieces together to do that. Well, I hope the video has been of interest, and obviously it's not one of those projects that's gonna, I'm not gonna rattle on through it like the Land Rover gearbox, because we had to get that done. Got plenty of time. Anyway, hope you enjoyed the video, and I'll update you again as soon as there's some more progress. Thanks for watching.